Let us consider binary classification. Let us denote class 1 as omega 1 and class 2 as omega 2. See class 1, see class 2. And the feature vector is denoted by x bar d cross 1. Let us consider d goes to 1. It means is having two features. X bar means some x1 comma x2, 2 cross 1 feature vector. And let us have the distribution for these features. If x bar of x bar, after knowing that it is from class 1, is likelihood distribution for class 1. Is following Gaussian, jointly Gaussian with mean value mu 1 bar, and covariance matrix for this one is sigma 1. And let us have the class conditional distribution for class 2 as follows: jointly Gaussian with mean vector mu 2 bar and covariance matrix sigma 2, where mu 1 bar is 2 cross 1, sigma 1 is 2 cross 2. Similarly, mu 2 bar and sigma 2, 2 cross 1 vector, this is 2 cross 2 matrix, sigma 2. The covariance matrix is a mean vector. Here the likelihood functions, for class 1 and class 2. And the prior probabilities for class 1 is P of W1, and prior probability for class 2 is P of omega 2. P of omega 1, P of omega 2. And the sum of these two is 1. Because we are considering two classes only, omega 1 or omega 2. P of omega 1 plus P of omega 2 equals to 1. Here the prior probabilities, here the likelihood functions. Let me try to expand this. And by root 2 pi whole power d, dimension of that x bar. Here d equals to 2 into square root of determinant of covariance matrix for this class omega 1 into e power minus x bar minus mu 1 bar transpose into sigma 1 inverse into x bar minus mu 1 bar divided by 2. And similarly, the likelihood function for class 2 is 1 by root 2 pi whole square, square root of mod sigma 2, determinant of sigma 2, e power minus x bar minus mu 2 bar transpose into sigma 2 inverse into x bar minus mu 2 bar divided by 2. And if you go for the minimum error classifier, which is same as margin a posteriori probability classifier, if according to this margin a posteriori probability classifier or minimum error classifier, if P of omega 1 into if x bar of x bar after omega 1 is more than P of omega 2 into if x bar of x bar after omega 2, then we can try to decode this like class omega 1. Otherwise, we will have to decode this like class omega 2. If this term is bigger than this term, then that is class omega 1. If this term is bigger than this term, then that is class omega 2. And the decision boundary can be formed between the two classes as follows. If this is bigger than this one, then that belongs to class omega 1. Now if you try to equate that one, then that is called as decision boundary. Try to equate this instead of greater than or less than. If you are having equality here, then you can call it like a decision boundary. Let us try to find the concentration boundary for this binary classifier. Just for the simplicity, for example, the prior probabilities are equal. It means both are equals to 1 by 2. In that case, you can try to cancel the two things. This is 1 by 2, this is 1 by 2, right? You can try to cancel them. Then that is more or less similar to your maximum likelihood classifier. Let us go with this. If P of W1 equals to P of omega 2, then we are going to have implies omega 1, otherwise that is omega 2 class. Let's write this likelihood function. Multiplied by equal minus. And we can try to go for the natural logarithm both sides. Before that, we can try to cancel this term, right? Root 2 pi whole square. Root 2 pi whole square. These two terms we can cancel. After that, you can simply go for natural logarithm for this. If you go for natural logarithm for this one, then we are going to get minus 1 by 2 ln mod sigma 1. Log of this. This term corresponds to mod sigma 1 whole power minus 1 by 2. If you apply logarithm for this one, we are going to get this minus x bar minus mu 1 bar transpose sigma 1 inverse x bar minus mu 1 bar divided by 2 greater than minus 1 by 2 ln mod sigma 2. It's a determinant of sigma 2. Minus x bar minus mu 2 bar transpose sigma 2 inverse x bar minus mu 2 bar divided by 2. Suppose if I consider the case where sigma 1 equal to sigma 2. For example, this is example case. Example 1. Let me go with that particular example. Let us consider mu 1 bar equals to 3 and 6 and mu 2 bar equals to 3 minus 2. This is mu 1 bar, this is mu 2 bar and sigma 1 equals to 2 0 0.02, and which is same as sigma 2 in our example, in this particular example. And we already taken prior properties are equal. P of omega 1 equals to P of omega 2. That assumption we have taken here. Now if you try to do simplifications with this data, then what we are going to get? Let us have a look into that. If you try to consider sigma 1 equals to sigma 2 in this particular example, the two gets cancelled out. Then we are going to get minus x bar minus mu 1 bar transpose sigma 1 inverse x bar minus mu 1 bar divided by 2. Because this term is equal to this term, we can cancel them. Because mod sigma 1 equals to mod sigma 2, as sigma 1 equals to sigma 2 in our example. D2 gets cancelled out. Then D2 terms left over. I am simply expanding them. If this term is bigger than x bar minus mu 2 bar into sigma 2 inverse into x bar minus mu 2 bar divided by 2. Then we can decode this like class omega 1. In this particular example, these two are equal, sigma 1 equal to sigma 2. Let us call this as sigma. Both are equal to sigma, which is same as 2002. Let us remove this term, this index. These two are equal, right? Then if you try to expand this, then what we are going to get is this two gets cancelled out. This will become like minus x transpose sigma inverse x transpose. Then after minus x transpose sigma inverse into minus mu 1 bar. Mu 1 bar. And if you do multiplication with this one, minus of minus is plus. This is plus mu 1 transpose sigma inverse x bar and plus mu 1 transpose sigma inverse into minus mu 1 bar. So it become like minus, right? Minus of minus is plus into minus is there. Transpose sigma inverse mu 1 bar. This is greater than, in place of mu 1 bar, we are having mu 2 bar. That's the only difference here. D2 gets cancelled out, this term and this term. It's a quadratic term. This quadratic term gets cancelled out. We are left with only linear terms in terms of x. These are linear. And let's have a look into this one. This term is same as this term. And this term is same as this term. The reason for this one is, you can try to see this. This is symmetric matrix in this case. Sigma equal to 2002 implies sigma inverse equals to 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2. This is sigma inverse. Inverse of this one. 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2. This is symmetric matrix, right? If you take the transpose of this one, we are going to end up with this. You can cross check this. Let me try to take transpose of this. Transpose sigma inverse mu 1 bar whole transpose equals to mu 1 transpose into sigma inverse transpose is same as sigma inverse, because sigma inverse is a symmetric matrix, into x transpose whole transpose means x bar. It means these two terms are equal, identical. I can simply go with this. Instead of writing this two times, we can simply have into 2 for this. And remove this, you can have into 2 for this. Similarly, you can try to remove this term and you can have 2h. Implies 2x transpose sigma inverse mu 1 bar, 2x transpose sigma inverse mu 1 bar minus mu 1 transpose sigma inverse mu 1. If this is bigger than 2 times x transpose sigma inverse mu 2 bar minus mu 2 transpose sigma inverse mu 2 bar, then we can try to decode this like class 1. Otherwise, we can decode this like class 2. It means omega 2. Let us substitute these values into this. Here sigma inverse equals to 1 by 2 0 0 1 by 2 and mu 1 bar equals to 3 and 6. And mu 2 bar equals to 3 minus 2. This is mu 1 bar, this is mu 2 bar. And if you try to substitute these into this expression, then we are going to get as follows. X transpose means x1, x2. Sigma inverse means 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2. Mu 1 bar means 3 and 6. Minus 3, 6. Sigma inverse means 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2. Mu 1 means 3, 6. If this is bigger than 2 times x1, x2, 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2, and this will be 3 minus 2, minus 3 minus 2, 1 by 2, 0, 0, 1 by 2, and this will become 3 minus 2. Then this will be decoded as class omega 1. Let us try to expand this. Once you multiply this, then we are going to get 3 by 2 and 6 by 2. It will become like 3 by 2 and 6 by 2 means 3. 1.5 and 3. This will become 3 by 2 and 3. And after this multiplication, we are going to get 3 by 2 and minus 1. Here also, this multiplication will become like 3 by 2 and minus 1. If we try to simplify this further, then we are going to get this 2 gets multiplied here, 2 gets cancelled out, 2 into 3, this will become like 6. Similarly, this 2 gets cancelled out here. 2 and 2 minus 1 will become like minus 2. See, minus 2. Then we are going to end up with 3x1 plus 6x2. Minus 3 into 3 by 2, minus 9 by 2. Minus 9 by 2 plus 6 into 3, 18. If this is bigger than if you try to multiply this, it will be 3x1 minus 2x2. And this product will be minus of 9 by 2 plus 2. This 9 by 2 gets cancelled out both sides. And this 3x1 also gets cancelled out. Then we are going to end up with this expression. 8x2 minus 18 greater than minus 2 leads to omega 1. Implies x2 greater than 16 by 8 implies omega 1 plus. Implies x2 greater than 2. Then we can decode it like omega 1 plus. Else decode it like omega 2 plus. It's a linear expression, right? In this case, our decision boundary is x2 equal to 2. This is a decision boundary, which is linear with respect to this x. This is linear, right? Linear decision boundary. If x2 greater than 2, decode like omega 1. If x2 less than 2, then decode that like omega 2. The picture is as follows. This corresponds to omega 1 class, this corresponds to omega 2 class, and this is a mean, mu 1 bar, it's a 2 dimension, right? X bar 2 corresponds, this is x1, this is x2, and this center point corresponds to, it's a mean, right? Mu 2 bar, this is mu 1 bar, is the means for them, and the decision boundary that we got is, if x2 greater than 2, then we are trying to decode that like class 1. This is the decision boundary we are having. x2 equals to 2, this is line, right? Linear decision boundary. If x2 greater than 2 implies omega 1, like this. x2 less than this 2, we are decoding that like omega 2 plus. It's a linear decision boundary. This mu 1 bar corresponds to 3, 6. This corresponds to 3 minus 2. Minus 2. It means this is 3. This point corresponds to minus 2. This point corresponds to 6. This is x2 coordinate. This is x1 coordinate. Let us have another example for this. Now we'll try to consider sigma 1 not equals to sigma 2. Earlier we considered sigma 1 equal to sigma 2 and we got a linear decision boundary at the end. Now we'll try to see what happens when sigma 1 not equals to sigma 2. Similar to earlier case, we'll try to go with 3, 6 for mu 1 bar. And mu 2 bar equals to 3 and minus 2. This is same as our earlier scenario, but this time we'll try to go with different covariance matrices. Sigma 1 equals to 1 by 2, 0, 0, 2. And sigma 2 corresponds to 2, 0, 0, 2. We should try to go with these sigmas, sigma 1 not equals to sigma 2. And as usual, we'll try to go with P of omega 1 equals to P of omega 2 equals to 1 by 2. And if you try to solve for that minimum error decision boundary, then we are going to end up with some nonlinear expression. You can simply try to substitute this sigma 1 inverse here and sigma 2 inverse here and mu 1 bar, mu 2 bar here. And if you simplify that one, then we are going to end up with this expression, final expression. The final expression we are going to get is this one. x2 equals to 3.514 minus 1.125 x1 plus 0.1875 x1 square. The final expression we are going to get. If our x2 is greater than this one, then that will be decoded as class 1. Otherwise, that is decoded as class 2. Now this will be omega 1. If that is less than this one, then that will be decoded as omega 2 class. It's a nonlinear expression, right? You can see this one. Nonlinear decision boundary. Decision boundary means we'll try to remove this inequality with equality. We'll try to replace this one with equality. Then that is called as a decision boundary. This is a nonlinear decision boundary because of this term, right? X1 square is there. Earlier we have only either x1 power 1 or x2 power 1 kind of thing. In our example, here this is just x2 equals to 2. This is a decision boundary. Just a first power, right? First order term. This is a second order term for this. It's a nonlinear decision boundary. Some sort of parabola, right? Let us try to have the pictorial representation of this one. This is class omega 1. This corresponds to class omega 2. And the center point corresponds to mu 1 bar. And this corresponds to mu 2 bar. Here also we considered this point to be 3, 6. And this to be 3 minus 2. And what we considered is sigma 1 equal to 1 by 2, 0, 0, 2. And sigma 2 equals to 2, 0, 0, 2. We can see variance along feature 2. This is a variance along feature 2, x2, variance along x2. That is higher, you can see. This is x2 coordinate, right? And this is x1 coordinate. Along this x2 feature, this variance is higher. You can see the spread of the data. Along this x1, the variance is 1 by 2. Compared to this, this is a bit smaller, right? The spreading is smaller. And that is, look into this coordinate. This spread is smaller compared to this spread. This is the print that one. In this case, this spread is same, right? Along x coordinate, the spread is same as the spread along this y coordinate. These two are equal here, right? 2 and 2. The spread is same. The variance will deal with this kind of thing, right? How much spread is there along this direction? Now the boundary we are going to get in this case is the decision boundary is non-linear decision boundary. Like this we got some sort of parabola. This non-linear decision boundary. X2 equals to 3.514 minus 1.125 x1 plus 0.1875 into x1 square. If our x2 is bigger than this one, above this, if x2 is bigger than this one, then we are trying to decode that as class omega 1. If that x2 is less than this one, then we are trying to decode that like class omega 2. It's a non-linear decision boundary, right? It's a case where sigma 1 not equals to sigma 2. We got a non-linear decision boundary. When sigma 1 equal to sigma 2, we are going to have linear decision boundary. When sigma 1 is not equal to sigma 2, then we are going to get non-linear decision boundary. In this example, that is second order, right? Second order non-linearity. Non-linear decision boundary. This is a decision boundary. Above this one class, below that, some other class. Thank you.